Welcome back. You know, part one, part two makes it seem like, you know, you're in some epic trilogy. No, we just lost power. So, our apologies. Where we were on part one was that Robin was sharing with us about how everything that she discovered about the actual missions we were doing, the International Court of Human Rights, the Arbitration Court of International Justice is its proper name, that we realized we needed to do a grassroots funding campaign. And we needed to let people know what the potential impact of a human rights court that was based in existing international law, but that was not subject to the deliberate limitations put in place with the International Criminal Court and the International Court of Justice, with the European Court of Human Rights, with the UN Human Rights Commission, all of these organizations which, you know, are populated by well-trained, well-meaning jurists, etc., but they are set up to essentially prevent any meaningful enforcement of human rights law in a way that would prevent the oligarchy from breaking the laws they break on a daily basis as their means of doing business. So we saw that we need to get the message out, and this required a skill set that our present Templar team at that time did not have. And that skill set had to do with reaching people, observing social memes, feeling the zeitgeist, knowing what was going on, knowing what can touch people, can reach people, can cut through all the fog and the BS out there and say, this matters, this can work, this is what we're doing, come be a part of it. And that's essentially how Robin Davis joined our team. She is a phenomenally talented communicator, both primarily visually but verbally as well. And if you go to justiceforhumanity.org, that's justice number four, humanity.org, you will see some of that brilliant work. And that is essentially, although it doesn't have a formal link to the Templars, that's a Templar mission. And the Arbitration Court of International Justice is primarily moved by people who are in the Knights Templar Order. So, Robin, I'd just like to ask you to share with us the process of the campaign, Justice for Humanity, how it came together, how you felt about its unfoldment, what was exciting about it, what was inspiring about it, and, you know, what were the lessons?
Well, the lessons were plenty, and we're still learning them, and that's just life, right? And especially the life of a spiritual seeker, which I've always been, Michael has always been, is just to march through it and improve as we go. Michael has also been witness to the fact that most of my creating, a lot of my creating and big flurries happen around episodes of what I like to call righteous anger. I have no tolerance for injustice. I have no tolerance for a billion people starving when we have enough food to feed them. I have no tolerance for bureaucracy that doesn't need to exist, that only serves to tie people in red tape so that they cannot be with their families, they cannot earn money, they cannot have any power. I don't have any tolerance for a system that is set up to keep us separated and weak. So, when I saw what they were working on, when I saw the foundation that was built so far and what they had in the court and what it needed, it's a tool that humanity needs and that already exists. But what they needed, as he said, the foundation is built. They had no Shakti. I have Shakti. And
Well, we didn't have no Shakti. We had
Shakti. No, I had a little Shakti, but, you know,
I told the
Grandmaster, it's the equivalent of, you know, the guys are at a party and they just, like, put out a bag of chips and take the dip top off, right?
That works.
Let's put it in a bowl, people. Let's be civilized, okay? Yeah. So, that said, I knew what they needed was what I could do. And I also saw them just completely stalled in the water for lack of funding when they had a solution that we as humanity need. and a foundation for other projects and missions, including the university that is built, and built in a new and modern way to be a host organization that can have online and real-world classrooms that bring together teachers and students from all over the world who otherwise would not have access to education of that level. It is built to support that, just as the court is built to support things. Now what needs to be done is the paint on the walls, the furniture, everything, and that's what I bring to it right now, an awareness that these exist, what they are, and then to hopefully bring in support. What I learned from the process and got me a little bit more righteous anger through our efforts at fundraising and building the branding with Justice for Humanity, one thing that's part of my job and one thing that I do is I observe behavior, feelings. I see what people are just shutting down from. I see what's confusing them. I see what's making them happy or ticking them off or whatever. And I feel it. And what I did was see that people are just overwhelmed, myself included, with everyone trying to do something good, people not trusting people. What organization do you trust? What do you not trust? Nobody wants to hear anything about lawyers at all, myself included. If I weren't working on it, didn't know the potential that it held, I would probably do the same thing. I tried to make it as fun as and modern as and accessible as possible, but I saw just overall what a challenge it is to all nonprofits, all those groups, all of these incredible light workers right now who are trying to fight just to survive, not, you know, much less do their work. That led me to another mission, which we are going to be launching on, which is a network of light workers and nonprofits and people like Project Camelot who are telling the truth, who are spiritually seeking, who are helping humanity, and a way for them to help come together, to be funded, and to broadcast their signal clearly, and to do our work. I was so moved by the time I worked with them for 6-7 months on something that just took on a life of its own, as our journey often does. And Prince Matthew offered me the title of Grand Dame. And it was quite a few months in, almost a year, mm-hmm. I think. I don't think he thought I would take it, which was probably smart, because I wouldn't have, like, 6 months ago even. But when I realized that all of my missions are their missions, and always have been, my lifelong missions, and beliefs, and foundation, and also the fact that he would offer that title to somebody as unconventional, non-linear thinking, a little wacky as me, I was like, okay, I'll hang with them. Yeah. Like, anybody would have me for a member. Yeah. You know? I'm like, okay, that's a cool club.
Right.
And I'm honored to be a part of this, and I'm honored to do everything I can with all my skill sets. I was never going to do branding again. I was never going to do any kind of advertising or anything with it. I took pictures of light workers and artists and children and families, and that was that.
Yeah, and oh, by the way, I didn't get a chance at the beginning. Robin has a really stellar background in social media, in advertising. She was with one of the top 5 major firms in the country in Chicago. Do I say her name?
Why not?
Yeah, Leo Burnett, corner office at Leo Burnett, you know, directing dozens and dozens of people. She had a door. She could close it.
Big deal.
That's power, people. She was actually an internet pioneer in the 90s, helped create one of the first blogs as part of the pioneering
dynamic. I heart the internet.
You what? You heart
the internet. I heart the internet.
Right. So,
it's freedom while we still got it, people.
So this brings us to another key point. You know, I'm going to keep bringing this back to the relevance and impact of what we're doing in the Restored Knights Templar Order here today on the 708th anniversary of the takedown of the Templars in 1307. Friday the 13th, that's where it came from, people, the bad luck.
It's now going to be good luck.
It's now going to be good luck because I'm going to keep bringing it back to the geopolitical and spiritual impact that we aim to have. What essentially the Templar Order offers for those who become part of it is we believe that, you know, if you're on a knightly quest, and I use those words very carefully and seriously, you know, since Don Quixote in 1604, when Cervantes wrote the hilarious send-up of chivalry, you know, a knightly quest is seldom used in a non-ironic way to unabashedly, wholeheartedly uphold the nobility and idealism of a knightly quest. We cannot, in the Templar Order, give anybody a knightly quest. A knightly quest is between you and spirit. It is given to you in your unique journey towards this reunion with Source by whatever spiritual path or you know cultural roots you come from. What we do is recognize people who are already on knightly quests. That's between you and the Holy Spirit as far as we're concerned. And we are here to provide support and fellowship and ideals and authentic history, legitimacy, a geopolitical structure. We are an actual nation-state subject of international law as a governmental, non-territorial ruling house that carries cultural Templarism as a national culture and represents it. You can go to our website and the government page, and that is all very well explained. But you know, the Templars were always about both geopolitical impact and spiritual communion. They were warrior monks. And that's what we're emphasizing for ourselves. That's what we are holding up the standard of the Code of Chivalry to live up to. And that's why our missions are what they are. Now, when it comes to what Robin was just sharing with us, the lessons we learned from Justice for Humanity and the network of networks that she is describing, the Templars were always innovators. You know, back in the day, they essentially invented the modern checking system, the beginning of the modern banking system, because they were protecting the pilgrims who were coming from Europe to the Holy Land, which was under Christian control. And it's a long, dangerous journey. And a lot of people got robbed and killed along that journey. So the Templars said, fine, don't take your gold across those, you know, couple thousand mile journey from France to Jerusalem. Deposit the gold at a Templar commandery. We'll create a coded document. And it'll be decoded. At the end of your journey, you carry a little document instead of gold that can be ripped off. That was the beginning of the modern checking system. The innovation that is needed today is essentially taking back the freedom of the internet, which is being gradually, piece by piece, whittled down and taken from us. The surveillance, the invasive ads, you know, the gradual corporatization of the former freedom of the internet. You know, Robin was there in the thick of it when the explosion of freedom and possibility in the early 90s was just washing over us all about the potential of the internet, which, you know, a number of people observed this could either liberate mankind or be used as the ultimate tool of enslavement. And the battle's still going on. The Templar Network, do you want to use the actual name?
Sure.
Okay.
And I can speak to
it. Yeah, so why don't you take it from there, and just because I'd love to be able to describe to people how, in addition to the human rights, in addition to the spiritual riches that we're offering to share with people, to me this is one of the key tools that the Templars are now helping to bring forward, and which is essentially a project that Robin began.
Thank you. One of the reasons I want to talk about it as well under the umbrella of the Templar support, like Michael said, which means so much to me, that they are basically, I have been working on this idea as a former internet pioneer and a social media pioneer at a.com before there was Facebook, building online community and a designer. My righteous anger came together with my spiritual growth path. And in the background, I had been working on a project that when I saw things that were going on and saw the internet, the way it was going and how it was kind of cluttered and controlled and things that were really good, though, that were happening, and I just get frustrated, and I came up with some ideas about ways that you could pluck out the really great stuff and the people who are doing amazing things and building amazing tools and take out the people who are controlling, the people who are using unfair practices and advantages over smaller entrepreneurs, and stopping the natural flow of information, which did exist in the beginning when I was starting to work in 1994 on the internet. And things, if things are let to flow like nature, they flow like this. It flows just like the Taurus flow. It flows naturally. Money flows, energy flows, people find each other. Everybody found the cool music, the cool book places, but then people came in and started to put walls around them and control them. What I was working on is a solution around that and also a home for people like us who all agree to these principles. I abandoned that for, you know, food and rent and my business, and I just kind of kept quietly working in the background. When I was working on Justice for Humanity, that became the primary focus of my extra efforts along with my work. And then when we kind of hit a wall in terms of what was what we were able to do in the realm and technologically and raising funds, I realized that the tool that I had created, that I had developed in my mind and on paper and had blueprints for, was the tool that we needed to yeah. move forward, and that so many organizations needed and so many people wanted. And the more I talked about it, the more people I got involved and the more amazing tech partners I found who were had similar visions. So that said, it's really important for me that the Templars recognized the value of this, that they didn't think I was crazy for thinking I could do it. This is not a Templar sanctioned PVOLT. Is the PVOLT network is not owned by the Templars. It is meant to be a gift for humanity, shepherded by me, but they are a supporting network. They are the first supporting network, and I think that that is so important, and PVOLT will support them back. Just like any natural and healthy relationship, it should be symbiotic, and they yeah. recognize that as well. So they're supporting my mission and my beliefs, and this has been something that is driven by spirit to me and is important to me. They recognize this. They recognize how it can help the order, how it can help the world, and that it aligns with their missions. And us synchronizing on this is incredible. It's going to be baby steps at first. Hopefully people who want to be involved with us, you know, are yeah. game to do that and co-create it with us. But we're excited today, whether it's just before midnight after my daughter's orchestra concert or not, it's going up today.
Yeah, October 13th, 708 years ago today.
That's right. So yeah. it's a communion of spirit seekers who believe that we can do something better, even if yeah. we start in tiny steps. And we're joining all of the missions in all of this, and it will give tools for the university, it will give tools for independent educators, it'll give channels for people to broadcast and receive and incorporate projects outside like Project Camelot to put their content on as well and receive yeah. funding.
Yeah, and just to focus a little more specifically on the problem that this addressed, which, you know, some of you out there may be familiar with. You know, if you look at the alternative community and if you look at all the causes that, you know, genuine light workers and humanitarians are out there trying to make a difference. Sacred activists are trying to make a difference. And everybody's going, I've got this great thing, please help fund. No, I've got, oh, I love your thing, but I've got this thing too. And could you give me a little funding? Could you give me, you know, and everybody's got, we're all competing for attention, competing for funding, competing to be, I mean, I love their human rights thing, but ours is really, you know, like, come over here because we need you. You know, there's this competition and dispersion of effort, and, you know, everybody's already under enough pressure, just trying to get through the day, you know, take care of your family, not slide into debt. You know, we recognize the enormous stress everybody's under, especially people who are trying to make a difference. Once you really raise your flag, obviously, as Kerry Cassidy can tell you, it you know, increases exponentially the attack energy.
But together,
see, this is as a network of networks, of everybody keeping their independence, their autonomy, their individual visions, the things that drive you personally, your nightly quests, if you will. Because we are creating a private media network of networks where everyone is able to broadcast, everyone is able to receive. There's going to be a larger feed of stuff that we are all very turned on by. There's a code of conduct that, you know, if you're, you know, doing hate speech or, you know, things that are bigotry or anti-women, or, you know, we find out that you're a cabal shill, well, I'm sorry, there's an
agreement. Trashing the planet.
Trashing the planet, things like that. But, you know, we have certain organizations, you just, bye, sorry, you're out, you're not part of the new internet, sorry. And there is a very important funding component to this, where because of what P-Vault, and if on the Templar site, you'll hear it referred to as the Templar Network, because that is the Templar network that is coming in under P-Vault, there is a direct supporting back from what we call the mothership to the individual networks. You bring a network to the table, there's various gradated levels of subscription, very affordable, all of them, and then there's a give back, a major give back that, you know, if you see the business model as this increases exponentially, can be a game changer. It's essentially rewriting the capitalist model to be back in what some of us refer to as sacred commerce, of the flow of life and energy in balance between divine feminine and divine masculine, not predatory, not separated into little competing boxes of dog eat dog, but one life, one human family, one generous, trusting, faithful exchange.
And making some giant hits on some giant dominoes we need to tip that will tip.
Right, yeah, like, you know, the water, the Human Rights Court, or others like it. By the way, you know, we don't claim that, for example,
food.
Yes, food. That the Human Rights Court, you know, is the only one we recognize. You know, there's many, many beautiful efforts taking place.
And sacred justice overall.
Yeah, sacred.
Honest,
exactly.
Fair justice practices.
And just to touch on that briefly, talking about, you know, the flow of divine masculine and divine feminine. When it comes to justice and enforcement of the existing human rights laws, the violations of which, systemic violations by the cabal, are how they maintain control. You need robust enforcement that they cannot ignore. You know, and then it's time, you know, once there's enforcement, once there's sheriffs at the door, once there's an enforceable judgment seizing assets, once it's game over, boys, you know, this is the human family's come together. Okay, then it's time to talk about compassion, and it's time to talk about, all right, Mother Earth has called you on your misbehavior, and you did your part in playing the dark really well. Game over, and maybe there's new roles, new you know, infusion of light, even into the darkest places of what we think of as the darkest souls, because I know that I need to recognize you got to do your own shadow work. I've got to do my own shadow work. If we're just demonizing the enemy and the bad guys and not allowing for the inevitability of divine compassion and redemption for all of us, then we're just buying into their paradigm again. And it's just another circle round. But in the meantime, enforceability. Divine justice first. So
I'll just add my little close on that point in doing our shadow work. In the introduction on our Facebook page, Michael mentioned that I would be talking about when we talked about the network mostly and our work that we're doing, I did want to recap exactly what you were saying, and it is a foundation of my beliefs and my spiritual growth path and what I believe that the Templars are all about at heart, and they are for me, is a community and a foundation for us to work on ourselves. Because without working on ourselves and our own shadows and being the best that we can be and be of service and humility and kind to ourselves, compassionate to ourselves as well as we walk this path and support one another, we can't fight any battles. So one of the things that the Templars are doing and aim to do as one of our missions is to provide the gnosis and the practices and the foundation for a strong family, for a strong self, and a strong spiritual foundation from which we can wage these wars against the darkness.
Yeah, and you know, that's something that you know, I have a 30-year background in meditation and my own spiritual path. But for the larger, you know, Templar order, and for those who are coming to us now and saying, all right, sacred activism, that's what I want in my life. Where do I begin? What can you offer? When we talk about the Gnostic heritage of the Templars, that transcends any specific religious structure. And that is about direct communion with Source. And that is going to be something that, you know, if you're Muslim and you come to the Templar Order, as many are actually because of the historic friendship between the Templars and the Sufis, between the Templars and their opponents in Arab chivalry, such as the great General Salah ad-Din, who was praised throughout Europe, famous for his chivalry. The Templars actually received much of what became the Code of Chivalry from the example of Arab chivalry, from the example of the nobility and generosity and compassion of a leader like Salah ad-Din. So that as people come to us, we can simply suggest places for them to go to deepen their practice of their own spiritual path, their own direct communion. Then there are those strains of Gnostic heritage that are unique to the Templar heritage. You know, specifically the lineage of Mary Magdalene, which is a pure Gnostic strain that still exists today, that has been carried on. As I mentioned earlier, the Ecclesia Gnostica Sanctuary in Redwood City, California, where I attended just this last Sunday, a Gnostic Eucharist in memory of the martyrdom of the Knights Templar, which was celebrated by Bishop Rosamund Ishkwakwi Miller, who is the carrier of the direct lineage of the Magdalene from an unbroken tradition in the south of France. That is something we are deeply grateful and inspired to have reconnected with. It really feels like a family reunion for us. And it also feels like, you know, the final activation and reunion. Really, it's alchemy on the higher level. You know, historically, people think of alchemy as, you know, trying to find the philosopher's stone to turn anything into gold. It's symbolic for a spiritual purification and the union of divine feminine and divine masculine within each soul. We each have those elements within us. The Gnostic heritage of the Templars goes way beyond the Templars to the Sufis, to the Essenes, to Pharaonic Egypt and beyond, to the mystery schools of Isis, and the name of the goddess will be reclaimed. And that is something that we are very grateful to have been put in touch with, an authentic, genuine, living tradition of that practice. And as we begin to share the If you go to our website, you'll see that part of the Templar heritage is the ancient Catholic Church, as well as the biblical priesthood of Solomon. Through the order of Melchizedek. Regarding the order of Melchizedek, let me just say, you know, you'll read a lot about that here and there on the web. Christ said in the New Testament, know that ye are priests unto the order of Melchizedek, meaning that he himself was a high priest of this same order. And Melchizedek is a semi-legendary biblical figure who actually blessed and initiated Abraham. So this was the holy king who essentially began the Abrahamic faiths, gave his blessing to the priesthood that Jesus and Mary Magdalene were later high priest and high priestess of. It is my personal belief that the order of Melchizedek exists on a higher plane, that they don't have a website. The Order of Melchizedek does not have a website. And the guides of that order, you know, they'll be in touch with us according to our own desire and merit, I guess. Huh? Go ahead, what'd you say?
I said, they have been.
They have been. They've been helping. Thank you. Anyway, so back to the anniversary and the launch and the practical aspects. If you've been following us and intrigued and think, I want to get engaged, I want to learn more, I share your values, I want to have impact in the areas you're having impact, okay, what do? KnightsTemplarOrder.org, by the end of the day today, there will be a live membership link which we have refined and streamlined, adapted to modern needs, but firmly rooted in the actual practice of the medieval Knights Templar. You'll find on our website that we are very careful not to unnecessarily change our heritage. The temple rule given to the order by Saint Bernard of Clairvaux is something that has been very carefully, delicately, judiciously updated by Prince Matthew and the Grand Mastery. And so in the old days, if you were joining the Templar Order, you didn't immediately just become a knight or a dame. There was a preliminary postulant period of training. We have amazing and wonderful materials for people to study, the Book of Ancient Secrets of the Templars. No more secret society stuff, folks. Wish everything that the Templars ever were, here it is. We're, part of our job is to put an end to the secret societies by sharing all the secrets.
And we'll be also bringing to the network and sharing with you the incredible talents of so many healers, ministers, and experienced spiritual leaders of all kinds, yeah, who have programs, webinars, who are geared up to work with us to share their gifts and their knowledge. So I'm super excited about that.
So when you would come into the order, there'd be a postulant period. We share some amazing material with you. And then for the sergeant and adjutants, as they are called, most of the members of the Templar Order back in the day were not knights and dames. They were full-on Templars. They were called sergeants. It was mostly male order, of course, that was entirely, though there were historically some women as well. If you look at the order, you will see that the sergeants and the appropriate French military equivalent for women is adjutants, rhymes with debutantes. And that is, you let us know the missions that excite you. You let us know, we're going to, you know, share with you the various areas we're working on, the human rights impact, the social media revolution. If you have a specific interest in Gnosticism, these are our major areas of interest right now. We'll start to work with you. We'll start to engage with you with some of our people who are leading these projects. And over time, as you're learning everything you want to learn about how to lead a life of chivalry, how to uphold these ancient universal human values, we don't pretend that it's just the heritage of European chivalry. These are essentially the best of humanitarian universal values, which it's just time to hold a banner high and dare to say yes
Being a knight or a dame is a beautiful, noble, necessary, practical, serviceable thing in the world today. In fact, it's probably one of the most essential things that we can champion.
And to that I'd like to add, when you go to the site, you will find that it is like a depth and richness of information. I also want to add, and that's Prince Matthew has done an unbelievable job in culling history and research and legitimacy. The other part of that I want to add is that this is not your father's Templar order. I always joke about that because the new missions and initiatives that we have and the work that's being done by people that we are aligned with is exciting, it's fun, it's modern, it's high-tech.
It's got the shock of Shakti.
It's got the shock of Shakti. And there are incredible things going on in commerce, in, you know, not just meditation, but changing the world, structures in home building, in, you know, everything from work being done with Gaia and the entire financial future of our world. People are doing incredible work, and we're working with them. We're so excited. Every day we meet somebody new who's doing things and is excited about what we're doing, and we're joining forces, and we're going to do this.
Yeah, it's an amazing time. So we also have, you know, if joining an order of chivalry is not your thing, but you like who we are and what we're doing, there's a level called Templar Champion if you want to receive the information, be on our list, receive our newsletter. You know, if you want to support us once in a while financially, you'll see there are essentially three levels. Just keep in touch with us, Templar Champion. Join the order, Templar Sergeant or Adjutant. And with each one of these levels comes the Templar Network, the revolutionary reclaiming of the internet that Robin and I were describing earlier. You know, and we've also...
And you'll be a co-creator in that. It's an ongoing mission to build it and improve it and also fund people who are creating incredible tech that you're not going to believe. Even the stuff we have to start with is incredible. And the people that we meet with, the tools that we'll be able to plug in there and mix and match as you want, is really exciting. And I think you'll be excited too.
And as far as becoming a knight or a dame, just to make clear how that flows, historically, you know, knights or damehood status is given as a nobiliary title in recognition of merit after, you know, we have got to work with you and know you and really respect your contribution. It's essentially a step up to a higher level of service and a recognition of who you are. So, you know, it's not something that you just join the order and boom, you're a knight Templar. You know, that's a status that we revere. It's something we aspire to. It means a step up to being an example, to doing your best to actually live a life of chivalry and service to sacred source and humanity. You know, we're not perfect. We're fallible human beings. We're not, you know, all of us are going to make mistakes. It's not like we're walking around with some, you know, aura of some phony aura of sanctity. But we're letting everybody know this is the standard we're asking you to hold us to, the code of chivalry. Go to the website. We present the ancient code of chivalry and also the Templar code, the specific things of the Knights Templar, of seeking communion with the feminine face of God, of preserving and defending sacred knowledge, the things that were unique to the Templars. So this is the date, the 708th anniversary of, you know, the takedown, and this is the comeback. And just another word for, you know, if you Google Knights Templar, you will see many organizations laying claim to the mantle of the Knights Templar. Some of them are good and admirable, are philanthropic, are Gnostic, are spiritual, and some of them are evil. Some of them are hate-mongering. Some of them are anti-Islam. Again, we are KnightsTemplarOrder.org. And for all of those good strains, authentic, spiritual, Gnostic, philanthropic organizations who have either a hereditary connection to some bloodline Templars, descendant of a Grandmaster, or the order that was begun sort of out of whole cloth in the mid 1800s by the Emperor Napoleon III. You know, those are authentic carriers of cultural Templarism, and we are not here to tell anybody that no, you know, you're not the real thing. What we're here to do is to offer support and cooperation with the structure, authenticity, international legitimacy, and the full heritage, cultural, archaeological, historical, spiritual, canonical, ecclesiastic, all of it, that it ever meant authentically in history to be a Templar. And on back before the founding of the order into the Sufi heritage, the Essene heritage, into the most essential light worker heritage. And by this I mean very specifically working with light in the grids of Gaia herself. That lighting up the grids at the most essential causal level of the shift that is happening, the ascension shift, the energetic shift, the love over darkness shift that is going on, is a light worker shift in a literal sense along the grids of Gaia herself. And that, to me, is a very moving recent discovery for me of Templaric work. So, you know, it's a very large picture. But so for those organizations that have their own heritage, loyalty is one of the most essential things in life. I admire the loyalty of the people I have met in the larger chivalric movement who feel, you know, they have been working with an organization that had a Templar link. And I'm not here to tell them that they're not the real thing or, well, now you guys can, you know, take your tent down. We offer cooperation for those who are actually interested in becoming part of the support that we offer. We respect your autonomy. We're not here to tell anybody that they're not the real thing or to interfere with who you are. We'd like to see if we can help each other. And we very much own and champion the authenticity and legitimacy and structure that we have put in place very painstakingly over many years to restore the order to its full legal, chivalric, canonical, ecclesiastical, apostolic status, the everything that it ever meant to be a Templar and more has been reborn and restored. So with that, I just want to say again, it's KnightsTemplarOrder.org. This is October 13th, 2015, 708 years to the day after the takedown of the Templars. And many, you know, the Templars survived underground for many centuries, and those threads spread all over the world, and now the family is coming back together.
That's right.
The sisterhoods are coming together with us, the Magdalene lineages. The Sufis are helping us in Egypt. We're just very moved and inspired by what's going on today. Again, as always, I want to thank Carrie Cassidy for her amazing work. And Brian and his team there are for our producers on the nightly news. And most especially, I want to thank this amazing woman, Robin Davis, the gutsiest, most creative, amazing cohort any Templar could ever wish to have. So, non nobis domine, sed nomine tuo da gloriam. That's the ancient motto of the Templars. Not unto us, O Lord, but to thy name be the glory. And with that, God bless us all. Have a beautiful day.
Let's ride.
Okay.
Welcome back. You know, part one, part two makes it seem like, you know, you're in some epic trilogy. No, we just lost power. So, our apologies. Where we were on part one was that Robin was sharing with us about how everything that she discovered about the actual missions we were doing, the International Court of Human Rights, the Arbitration Court of International Justice is its proper name, that we realized we needed to do a grassroots funding campaign. And we needed to let people know what the potential impact of a human rights court
or a system that is set up to keep us separated and weak. So, when I saw what they were working on, when I saw the foundation that was built so far and what they had in the court and what it needed, it's a tool that humanity needs and that already exists. But what they needed, as he said, the foundation is built. They had no Shakti. I have Shakti. And
well, we didn't have no Shakti. We had
no, I had a little Shakti, but, you know,
I told
the Grandmaster, it's the equivalent of, you know, the guys are at a party and they just, like, put out a bag of chips and take the dip top off, right?
That works.
Let's put it in a bowl, people. Let's be civilized, okay? Yeah. So, that said, I knew what they needed was what I could do. And I also saw them just completely stalled in the water for lack of funding when they had a solution that we as humanity need. And a foundation for other
people. About it, what was inspiring about it, and, you know, what were the lessons?
Well, the lessons were plenty, and we're still learning them, and that's just life, right? And especially the life of a spiritual seeker, which I've always been, Michael has always been, is just to march through it and improve as we go. Michael has also been witness to the fact that most of my creating, a lot of my creating and big flurries happen around episodes of what I like to call righteous anger. I have no tolerance for injustice. I have no tolerance for a billion people starving when we have enough food to feed them. I have no tolerance for bureaucracy that doesn't need to exist, that only serves to tie people in red tape so that they cannot be with their families, they cannot earn money, they cannot have any power. I don't have any tolerance for...
Can touch people, can reach people, can cut through all the fog and the BS out there and say, this matters, this can work, this is what we're doing, come be a part of it. And that's essentially how Robin Davis joined our team. She is a phenomenally talented communicator, both primarily visually but verbally as well. And if you go to justiceforhumanity.org, that's justice number four, humanity.org, you will see some of that brilliant work. And that is essentially, although it doesn't have a formal link to the Templars, that's a Templar mission. And the Arbitration Court of International Justice is primarily moved by people who are in the Knights Templar Order. So, Robin, I'd just like to ask you to share with us the process of the campaign, Justice for Humanity, how it came together, how you felt about its unfoldment, what was exciting that was based in existing international law, but that was not subject to the deliberate limitations put in place with the International Criminal Court, and the International Court of Justice, with the European Court of Human Rights, with the UN Human Rights Commission, all of these organizations which, you know, are populated by well-trained, well-meaning jurists, etc., but they are set up to essentially prevent any meaningful enforcement of human rights law in a way that would prevent the oligarchy from breaking the laws they break on a daily basis as their means of doing business. So we saw that we need to get the message out, and this required a skill set that our present Templar team at that time did not have. And that skill set had to do with reaching people,
observing social memes, feeling the zeitgeist, knowing what was going on, knowing what